Thank you, Michael, for all the kind words about me. We have a really common history without knowing each other. The magazine which Michael started, I learned about that several years after its publication, because at that time I was in exile in Siberia and didn't hear anything. Suddenly, when I returned to Moscow, I met a young man, later I learned, don't tell anybody that he is actually older than me, but because he doesn't like that idea. But at that time it was a very lively young man. He said, "Oh, Pavel, we met at a party in Moscow after my return from exile. Do you know that you gave me a job?" I said, "No, I don't know. I didn't know that I gave a job anybody." And he told me the story which you heard about the foundation of founding of Index of Censorship. And since that time we became friends, and they met after immigration Michael many times, but several words about the beginning of that thing. When I will mention some names, I won't mention that most of them are dead, so I'm kind of still dinosaur survivor for a while, so if somebody is alive, I will mention, but if I didn't mention, it means that they already passed away. Anyway, with two friends in Moscow, whom I want to mention, Andrea Malrik, who at that time was a known historian, who already spent several years in exile for so-called being parasite, because he didn't work officially, although he worked very hard on his writing, and Karl van het Revne, Dutch journalist and author who came for a year as a foreign correspondent of Swedish, not Swedish,
Dutch
magazine. Forgot the name of it. Anyway, three of us became close friends. We had all different experiences, but Karl was a Westerner. He really knew the Western world. And some of the ideas we understood about what's going on in the West came from him. So when I wrote that letter, and Andrea Malrik was there, and I gave it to Karl von Hetrebe, it was August 16, 1968, 7 days, 7 days, no, 9 days before I was arrested in Red Square, and it was 4 days before Soviet invasion of Czechoslovakia. And I said, "Karl, you know, I'm probably seeing you for the last time for many years, because you're leaving now for back to you to Holland. And I will go to labor camp very soon." I didn't know for what and how, but it was clear that that I will be arrested. What should I do? And he said, "Why don't we think about getting some connection so our work won't disappear?" And the idea to send a letter to Westerners who already supported me and Larissa Bogoraz when we started our human rights movement, came from him, and that's what brought about Index of Censorship and friendship with international, with Amnesty International and Writers and Scholars International and Michael's magazine. So that letter was addressed to basically a wide number of people, but it was received by a poet, Stephen Spender, and he definitely, because he organized that letter of support to me and Larissa Bogoraz, so he also was the driving force behind all these publications. I just wanted to mention those remarkable people. And Andrea Malrik, since that time, wrote several great autobiographical books, and his most famous, basically prophetic book, Will the Soviet Union Survive Until 1984? If you look at this book today, you will see how many features of the world after fall of the Soviet Union happened, and he was correct about it. Anyway, I very soon had to emigrate from the Soviet Union and came to the United States. And what did I do in the United States? Of course, for a living, because I was a professor of physics, I couldn't find teaching position in university, but started to teach in high school, and for 13 years I taught physics and mathematics in private school in the United States. But most of my time, except for family and teaching, was devoted to publishing Tamizdat. And that's what I did. Tamizdat was my life, and Tamizdat was special type of Tamizdat. It was Tamizdat in defense of human rights. Tamizdat of political and human rights type, which is very important, because the real Tamizdat, literary Tamizdat, poetry of Brodsky, novels of Solzhenitsyn, novels of Nabokov, couldn't be distributed without people reading them in those countries for which it was they were written. Not in the West, but in Russia, in Greece, and anywhere on what language they were written. And to survive, they needed readership. And readership had to distribute them. And these distributors and authors of Samizdat and Tamizdat, they needed the protection, they needed the defense. And that defense became human rights movement, became foundation of political and human rights Samizdat. I was one of the first political samizdatchik, but before I had the predecessors. There was a Russian writer and journalist, Frida Vigdorova, who made her name by doing a very simple thing, sitting in a trial of Yosif Brodsky, who was sentenced to 5 years for so-called social, being social parasite, because he wrote poetry and didn't make any money for that poetry. And because he didn't make any money, it means that he was social parasite. And they sent him to 5 years of exile in the north of his home in Leningrad. And Viktor was sitting at that trial, and in spite of harassment by judge, she wrote basically everything what was happening. And her record, her transcript of that trial was published, of course not in Russia, but in the West, and transmitted by Voice of America and BBC back to Russia, and it became first pravozashitny human rights Tamizdat, that record of the trial. Very clear, very simple, relatively short, 40 pages or something, whatever was possible. And after that, a friend of mine and friend of Viktor, Alexander Ginsburg, made a collection of documents which was called White Book, the trial of Sinyavsky and Daniel, the writers who were arrested because they published their books abroad, because they were Tamizdatchiks. And Alexander Ginsburg made a book. I was also participant of that book, because part of that book was articles, translation of articles and mentioning of the trial in Western press. And I, Alec Ginsburg, got a big pack of these clippings from Western press and gave them to me, and I distributed them to my friends, and we translated those things into Russian, and Alec Ginsburg included them in his book. That was the next volume. And then Alec Ginsburg, for that work, together with Yuri Glanskov and others, was also arrested, including even even Vera Lashkova, who was a typist, one of the typists of that book. And what I did the next. I did the book, which was called The Trial of the Four. That's how it looks in Tamizdat way. That book, which was published in the West, by the way, by Karel van Ketreve, which I mentioned in Holland, who started publishing house of Gerson. So, and parallel with that, I published another book. Again, published means that I did it in Samizdat. And it was devoted to one of the many trials, but it was the first known trial of Vladimir Bukovsky, which was also a collection of documents and articles about his case. So that was my contribution to beginning of Tamizdat. Of course, all these words, Tamizdat, maybe deserve definitions, and as I understand, I wasn't here yesterday, there was a lot of discussion, but we know what Samizdat is. Samizdat, something which was circulated without blessing of official publishing house in Russia, you know, or in Poland, or wherever dictatorship exists. Come from a joke, which means my self-publishing house. Actually, the joke was longer. It was poet Nikolai Glaskov, whom I met right before he died. He published in Samizdat small copies of his poetry, half of typewritten page, which was called Samizdat, myself. Publishing house, but somehow some CBS that was too long, and people abbreviated it and became Samizdat. And Samizdat appeared as the real second generation joke, that if it's Samizdat, when Samizdat reaches the West, it becomes Tamizdat. What is Tam? Tam is there, and what is there when you're over there? It's here. That's the origin of these words, and I don't think we have to argue about them too much. I wanted to remind if anybody has any doubts where the words came from. Of course, the meaning of the words also depends where are you talking. If I'm talking here, Tamizdat is just book, just something published here. It's nothing else, or something which can be discussed in a lecture hall during the conference, but really it's not Tamizdat. It's just a book translated from Russian or Polish or Greek and published in this country in English, or maybe sometimes published in Russian and smuggled back into Russia, to Ukraine, and so on. But if in Russian it's Tamizdat, it means it's something very valuable, very interesting, and very dangerous, because Samizdat is bad, but it's typewritten, it's kind of internal thing. But it's Tamizdat, it means you are part of conspiracy, part of the things which are smuggled with participation, probably CIA, probably some dangerous spies. So that's a kind of some special thing. So the kind of how these words look depends where and who pronounces them. They don't have objective characteristic what is them. But anyway, when I came to this country, I became Tamizdatchik. What kind of Tamizdatchik I became? I joined my friend who already was emigrated. Actually, he didn't emigrate. I'm talking about my friend Valery Chilidze. He came to this country to with official permission to give a cycle of lectures in New York and in Washington, officially with legal permission, gave talks about human rights. And then 3 weeks or something after he was in New York, suddenly in his hotel number, there was a knock at the door, and he opened the door, and there was two Soviet officials. One of them was consul or something in New York and said, Господин Челидзе, why don't you give us your passport? We want to check it. And he gave them the passport, and they he put it in his pocket, and then took it out of his pocket the official looking document that Господин Челидзе, you are deprived of Soviet citizenship because you committed anti-Soviet propaganda, something like that. Violated or behaved not like it becomes to Soviet citizen, something like that. And since that time, Valery Chelidze stayed in the United States, and he started to publish Tamizdat. It was political Tamizdat. It was human rights Tamizdat. It was called Khronika Press. He was joined by two people at the beginning, Ed Klein and Peter Redway, and they started to publish a magazine, Chronicle of Human Rights in the USSR. I will explain the complicated story with those chronicles, but it's too much probably, too much detail. And many books, of course, probably 100 books or more. After I emigrated, was forced to emigrate from Russia, came, I joined the magazine, Chronicle of Human Rights. It was published for many years in both Russian and English. Valery Chelidze was the driving force, and basically he wrote most of the magazine. I was helping him. And Ed Klein translated and wrote himself part of that magazine in English. Why that Chronicle of Human Rights in the USSR? I have to go back again to Russia, because when I finished those two books about the case of Bukovsky and demonstration in Pushkin Square and the case of Ginsburg and Glanskov, it became clear that the violations of human rights are so many in Russia. People are arrested, people are expelled from Communist Party, people are expelled from work, people put into mental hospital because of their political activity. That to write a book about each of these cases is impossible and impractical. And appeared the idea that we shouldn't do such books anymore because it's a waste of time and impossible. But to get all the materials and make a magazine publication which will just document everything which was happening in labor camps, in mental hospitals, in different parts of Soviet Union. And this magazine was started by Natalia Gorbanevskaya with my help, and she published in Samizdat first 10 copies. It was called Chronicle of Current Events. There were 67 or copies of that magazine, which was sometimes bi-monthly, sometimes more rarely, sometimes it was break for several years, but it continued until the Soviet Union basically collapsed. This magazine, this publication, or bulletin, there were different ideas, had its own history. All publishers, all editors of Chronicle of Current Events sooner or later went to prison or to mental hospital, but it continued. But at some moment, right before I left Russia, it stopped because most of the editors were arrested, and there was threats that if anybody will start, will continue to publish it, they will start arresting people who even don't participate in the magazine. It was a pure hostage taking, pure blackmail. And my friends, Tanya Velikanova and Sergei Kovalev and others, decided to temporarily stop the magazine. And when I came to the United States, I said the magazine will, magazine stopped, but it will start again, and if it will start again, will publish it. But during that break, started the other chronicle, Chronicle of Human Rights. So that's why two chronicles existed parallel, and then the first one stopped, and when the second one appeared again. I confused everybody, but I'm not going to go into that. Just different names, different magazines. But they became very important because they were very accurate, very precise, very apolitical in one important thing, which already was mentioned, that it was not criticized, didn't discuss political opinions which were exercised by political prisoners and others in Russia. It was basically a magazine about persecution and harassment, arrests, and others of people who spoke up their mind, no matter where was it left, right. There were religions. There were people who were pacifists. There were pro-communists. There were socialists, anti-communists. Practically everybody, even occasional fascists appeared, and everybody was defended because everybody was supposed to be defender of human rights. If they speak up, they can speak up. And that was the magazine in which I participated for many years, all my life in the United States, at least until the Soviet Union stopped existing. I still continue to work for human rights in Russia and interest in human rights in all other countries, but activity of this magazine stopped. But it was not only magazine, it was publishing house. Ed Klein, our American founder, who raised the first money, he was a businessman and he knew how to raise money better than others, and he contributed his own money in the beginning. And he was an activist of Amnesty International and many other things. Why do I talk about that line? Okay, I can talk about that line a lot, but I don't remember why I started to talk about him. I know. Because he was a mathematician and businessman who studied in Yale University, and in Yale University he met some Russian specialists who led him interest in Russian literature. He started to read Russian literature, fell in love with Russian culture, and because of that, he decided to start, on advice of his English friend, professor, what's his name?
Max Hayward.
Max Hayward. Thank you. I knew that you're here, you won't let me forget the name. Max Hayward, great translator and author. Max Hayward told him that there is a great Russian, old Russian, first immigration publishing house called Издательство имени Чехова, Chekhov Publishing House. And that Chekhov Publishing House published maybe hundreds of, or at least 100 books of very interesting immigrant literature. But it lost, didn't have money, nobody wanted to give it support, and Ed, for relatively little money, bought the name of this publishing house and started to publish several excellent books, including Soviet authors and some emigre authors, Надежда Мандельштам, Anatoly Gapson, and others. And the Khronika Press, the publication of ours, the magazine, and all other books, which published Sakharov, published all important human rights dissident in Soviet Union, became affiliate of this Chekhov publishing house. So they became together, and sometimes certain books were published by Chekhov publishing house, certain by Chronicle, Chronicle Press, and together we published, as I said, 100 books, mostly in Russian. How these things appeared? Where did they come from? Of course, most of these books originated in Russia. Some of them were information from labor camps. How did information from labor camps reach us? Where we were located? About 25 blocks north of this place, on 92nd Street, there was an apartment where Khronika Press had had its press. It's a small IBM computer, this, which was slowly and broken down very often, printed it. There was several people sitting in the small office, about 1/10 of this room, and they were getting all information. Sometimes it was on a piece of paper, sometimes on something, letter, sometimes telephone call. We would get information about what happens in labor camps. Sometimes it would come by the way I will describe it euphemistically, it would come from labor camp, and in labor camp sometimes it would be smuggled in some internal organs of prisoners or their spouses, and these things which were pretty smelly and very small print and a very bad quality was had to be opened very carefully and read and transcribed. And there was a young girl, she was probably 11th grader, Russian immigrant girl called Lena Stein, who was 11th grader in New Jersey, Jersey City School. She would do all this smelly work, describe it, and it will appear as the result in Chronicle of Human Rights. That's how the information was arriving, how that type of samizdat, how people were suffering in labor camps, would reach New York and appear in Tamizdat. And of course, Tamizdat was very often transmitted back into Russia by means of Voice of America and Radio Liberty and BBC, and people learned about that, and the information circulated. So it had a complicated life, and that's what I wanted, just to give some idea what it was and how important it is. And of course, human rights is an important issue, and that issue is not dead. The Soviet Union is dead, communism is dead, but we see in the whole world, even in our, for me, saintly America, we have a president who doesn't respect human rights. So it means the problems exist, and some is that and some is that necessary, not just as literature, but as a defense of human rights. I will finish it.
But you three. Just a footnote, Robin, it may interest you to know that the man who I think was your father's handler in the Academy of Sciences, Fyodor Konstantinov, prepared a report about his stay, a graduate student of my pen, included it in his dissertation, and among other things, he said that your father had planted you in a Soviet school for the express purpose of reporting on the moods of Soviet children and their parents' opinions. So you were being watched. Pavel Mikhailovich, I have a question for you about that letter of August 16th, 1968 to Stephen Spender, in which you proposed something that eventually became Index on Censorship and also the Herzen Foundation in Amsterdam. I think with your characteristic modesty, you have given credit for the idea to Karel van het Reve, but in the research that I've done during that period, on the eve of the Soviet invasion of Czechoslovakia, you were engaged in a very intense discussion with Viktor Krasin and others about what institutional form this nascent dissident movement should take. Should there be a committee? Should there be leaders? Should there be presidents? Should there be a division of formal division of labor among the leaders of the movement, including yourself? And you and Larisa Bogora staked out what I would call a radical voluntarist position, which is that there should be no committees, no leaders, no structure, no authority, and no moral pressure put on anybody to play any particular role. It should be absolutely voluntary. And I have the impression that one of the meanings of the letter that you sent to Spender is that, correct me if I'm wrong, you were essentially outsourcing the administrative work of the movement to the West. And this has sometimes been interpreted as, well, of course you did that because to have formed a committee and had formal roles would have served you up on a platter to the KGB. It would have been an invitation to all of your arrests. But I do think that some of the, especially your correspondence with Grigoryenko at the time, you really indicated a desire not to have any formal organization whatsoever and to let people in the West take care of that. Is there any merit to that?
Yes. Should I go back or? I don't know how to do it. Will it work?
Sure.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Gwen, for raising this important question. At that time, I would say it's important at that time, in 1968-69, our rejection of communism with its so-called democratic centralism, which was, of course, euphemism, and pressure, moral pressure and all types of leadership was so strong that we had to release ourselves with completely, honestly, volunteer organization. I would say it was temporary, but we didn't think about that as temporary. We just thought that we were not ready for parties, for organizations. It all appeared later. But even organizations which appeared first in human rights movement, they were all volunteer organizations without serious leadership. I'm talking about initiative group for human rights, human rights committee, and Helsinki group. They had most active people, like Yuri Fedcharlov, but basically they didn't have leaders, and it was definitely everybody was equal. Everybody took as much work as they could and went to camps or somewhere without being. Of course, modern political organization cannot exist without being really some kind of leaders, presidents, leaders of the party. It has to be. But at that time, we didn't have it. There was certain naivety in that time, but I think it's important that we didn't have it, and human rights movement was human rights movement, not the movement against communism or against something, although we were all anti-communists, but we even didn't like that word. Like Anatoly Kapson said to Grigoryenko once, Grigoryenko said, let's publish a magazine, anti-Stalinist, and Jakobson, with his bluntness, said, Petr Grigorievich, I don't want to call myself anti-governor, anti-shit. There was a strong feeling that we are for permission of people speak up their mind. How they think will develop, it will be future. So I'm glad that you mentioned this thing.
Thank you. If you give me 1 minute to preface my question, my name is Cynthia Roberts. I'm a professor of international relations here at Hunter. And this brings back incredible memories for me because I started my young career, as it were, as a young student studying Russian and consumed by the debate between Solzhenitsyn and Sakharov and came to actually get to know some of the people you've talked about, recruited by Lilia Stein to do a summer's work with Chalidze. And it was Ed Klein who actually encouraged me to make my first trip to the Soviet Union, which turned out an affair to be almost like yours, because I ended up traveling illegally for 2.5 weeks in the Soviet Union, of all places, as still a young teenage girl. And from there, I went on to study a host of other things more related to Soviet politics and international relations. But in recent years, I've gone back to working in the archives and was struck in visiting places like the Sakharov Museum, the new and the earlier Gulag Museum, and getting to know some of the directors. There are very small exhibits on samizdat, and I wonder if there's been any fruitful exchanges in terms of document sharing or productive scholarship in this sense. I apologize, I missed yesterday. I had to teach all day. So if you have insights on this, I'd be really interested. Thank you.
Maybe it's not me to answer the questions, but there is many exchanges. There is Memorial, there is Sakharov Museum, and there are plenty of exhibits and plenty of things happening. So I'm sure that Ben probably could tell much more about those exchanges, how they existed today.
Sorry to take the last question, but we have barely spoken yesterday, or even today, or even during this panel, about such an institution as the embassy and the channel of transferring Tamizdat, whether political or literary, through diplomatic pouch. Of course, Polina's talk yesterday was largely driven by this channel, but is there anything the three of you would perhaps like to say?
My knowledge is very, very, my knowledge is limited to one thing, which was that the way that Requiem came out was through the diplomatic pouch, and it wasn't, my mother wasn't a journalist, and the pouch was not supposed to be used in that way, but at the time, the cultural attaché at the American Embassy was Jack Matlock, who later became the ambassador much later. But at the time, he was a young man, and he did this. He volunteered to include the poem in the diplomatic pouch, and that was very generous and courageous of him, obviously.
So, yeah. There was another. Question. Oh, I've forgotten his last name. Ilya, who was cultural attaché.
Levin.
Ilya Levin did the same. That's all I wanted.
Is this working now? Yes. One of my huge problems is a terrible memory. So, and I wish I could tell stories the way Pavel told them. But what I remember is that once we started Index, the material just poured in. And I think sometimes I knew the source. But it was this network, there was a certain network of, exiles. It's gone. Is that better? For instance, we talked about Zappis earlier. The Poles were very visible. So they would come to me. I didn't ever had to go anywhere to get this stuff. And basically, I didn't ask questions. I mean, strange as it may sound, but it could have come through the diplomatic pouch. It could have been brought by I think journalists were quite a good source, actually. Journalists were being handed stuff in Moscow and in Warsaw, and they would bring it.
Diplomats.
Pardon?
Diplomats.
Yeah, well, diplomats as well, yes. But I didn't ask. I didn't really want to get, just like you didn't get do certain things. My job was just to get it out. And a lot of our readers, in turn, were journalists. That was also, we were a sort of medium between the original language and the journalists were, and that was our hope, that they would pick up our stories and write about them and broadcast them, and often they did. I've been away from this subject a long, long time, as some of you know, and it's the first time I've gone back and thought seriously about Index, thanks to Yasha, in a very long time. But I do have that very strong memory of, we didn't publish even, I would say, half of what came in the end. That was the other thing. In fact, the Index archive, for what it's worth, is at Bishopsgate Institute in London. And everything that came in, so far as I know, is there, including quite a lot of Russian. A lot would be maybe an exaggeration, but certainly what we were translating, we received that way. Oh, and I should say, by the way, I mentioned academe. Translators. I don't know where they got these things from, but translators would come and say, I've just translated these poems by Grobanevskaya, for instance. Where are you interested? Well, of course, we were extremely interested. So it's not a really a very helpful answer to someone who studies this subject, but all I can say is that a lot of it was done clandestinely and secretly, and that's what you have to uncover.
On this note, let's please applaud our participants. Take a 15-minute break, and please.